We're going to be looking here this morning in the book of 1 Samuel, particularly. And in 1 Samuel, looking in chapter 13 in verse 14. And I want to just take a moment and read that here this morning and then just ask the Lord to join with us as we minister the Word of God. So it says this in 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 14, "But now your kingdom, Saul, shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart. And the Lord has commanded him to be commander over his people because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you." Can we go to the Lord in prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, I thank you that you are seeking those who are after your heart. Lord, I pray that today our hearts be so pierced, Lord God, that we begin to chase after you instead of after the things of this world. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The title of the message this morning is After God's Heart. And actually, this is kind of an introductory message to a theme I'm going to be preaching just through the life of David. Man, I am so impressed, not like impressed, like puffed up. I'm impressed deeply, like being impressed upon by the life of David. It stirs up faith within me because David wasn't perfect. I mean, and that's one thing that I can identify with, you know. I mean, David had problems. He had issues, but David was a powerful guy, and he was a guy who really made an impression upon the people of Israel and still do today. So I want to talk about the life of David and what does it mean to be after God's heart. But before I really get into the message, God spoke a word into my heart this week. And I just want to take a moment and share that with you. And it's a prophetic word. And I believe as God just allows me this morning, I want to take a moment and just prophesy to you here today. The word that God spoke into my heart was this word called capacity. God is saying to the church today that we lack the capacity for the harvest that he is bringing in this next generation. That as this generation gets stirred up by the things of God, as God begins to pour out his spirit upon all flesh, as it reads in the book of Joel, that he is bringing a great harvest into the land. And church, we ain't ready yet. He says it's time for us to increase our capacity. It's time for us to increase our willingness. It's time for us to increase our abilities in him. Come on, somebody. I believe that God is bringing a harvest into this community, and we're not ready. I see chairs that are still have nobody sitting in them, but we're not ready. There ain't enough empty chairs to fill what God is going to bring into this church and into his body. I believe we need more buildings. We need more home groups. We need more Bible studies. We need more worship huddles. We need more people going out and doing the things of God, because God says we need to increase our capacity. He showed me that we can increase our capacity two ways. Capacity is simply this: capacity equals willingness plus ability. We are limited by our willingness to do the things that God has called us to do. I'm so glad that David sang a song, "Lord, here I am, here I am. You can have it all." Because that's what it's going to take, my friends. I'm not saying that you need to quit your job and go into the ministry. I'm not saying that you need to stop what you're doing and go move overseas. All I'm saying is, Lord, that you need to look to the Lord to use you in the exact capacity that he has you in today. God has put you where you are for a time such as this. Increase your willingness to say yes to the things of God. Increase your willingness to say, "Lord, use me." Come on, just say that with me right now. Say, "Lord, use me." God can use you. I am so excited about what God is doing. God is opening doors that have never been opened before. Unorthodox, unordinary, unheard of doors that I've never seen happen before. We have the ability to speak into governments, to speak into businesses, to speak into education systems, to speak into families like never before. God is opening the doors if we would just be willing to walk through them. Come on, would you say, look at your neighbor and say, "I'm willing." Come on, look at your other neighbor and say, "They're willing." Come on, we need to hold each other accountable sometimes. We make every excuse to not do the things God has called us to, and it limits the capability of the church. The other thing we can do to increase our capability is to improve on our ability. Come on, you know what the greatest ability on the face of the planet that a Christian could have? It's availability. Come on, just making ourselves available, saying, Lord, give me some margin in my life to do the things that I need to do, to show up to the prayer meetings, to show up to the Bible studies, to show up to the discipleship groups, to quit making excuses for not growing in my faith. God, increase my abilities. But I know people that are some of the most gifted, talented people on the face of the planet. They have one word in their vocabulary. It's no. So you can have the best of ability, but if you ain't willing, you're limited in your capacity by your willingness. Some people are so willing, but man, they couldn't sing a song on the radio with a radio. So they're limited in their ability. And sometimes we need to increase our willingness and our ability. Is this making sense to anybody? God is bringing a harvest. It's not about church growth. It's not about church. I genuinely believe that the message of the gospel is powerful. And when people in the church begin to grab hold of this idea that it can begin to save those that are lost, and people hear this message of salvation through Jesus Christ, man, we don't have enough room in the buildings. We don't have enough care pastors. We don't have enough ministers. We don't have enough worship leaders. We can fix the building problem. We can rent buildings. We can do what we got to do. It's not about growth. It's about being obedient to the call of God on our lives and increasing our capability. So this morning, this is totally not. How many electricians are here? Anybody have an electrician? Brother Rex, couple electricians? Y'all know what a capacitor does, right? This is going to make sense. As a Christian, we need to begin to operate like a capacitor. We need to begin to store up. A capacitor does this. All it does is stores up energy for a specific purpose, for a specific moment. Your television at one point in time, I don't know if they still do or not, used to have a capacitor in it. You can unplug your TV, and if you took that old tube TV apart and you went and grabbed that capacitor, what would happen? Bad day. Bad day. I mean, I don't know if it'll kill you, but man, it's going to be a bad. You're only going to do that once, because that capacitor is actually storing electricity within itself to turn the TV on. It's for whenever something needs a tremendous amount of energy at one moment, the capacitor is there to bring that energy. And as Christians, we need to operate as little capacitors for the kingdom of heaven. When we come to church on Sunday, come on, it's not just so we can hear a message, friends. It's so that we can be filled to overflowing with the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. And we walk around as capacitors in this world. When we come in contact with the lost, when we come in contact to the addicted, when we come in contact to the discouraged, we can just say, here, grab my hand. I've got some power within me to change your life, to jumpstart what God is already wanting to do in you. It's time for the church to increase our capacity. Amen. I'm ready. I mean, I'm ready. I'm ready. Man, I am sick and tired of just the same old, I'm ready. Come on, I'm ready to see the world changed. I'm ready. I'm ready for God to move. I don't want to talk about it any longer. I want to live in it today. I want to see God touch lives today the same way he touched my life. Miss Margaret, the same way he touched your life, the same way he touched your life, Brother Phil. Every one of us has a testimony of the power of God. And I'm sick and tired of the world just saying, well, that stuff ain't real, brother. That stuff ain't real. It's real. It's real. Increase our capacity for the things of God. Willingness plus ability equals capacity. Maybe we don't know how to increase our capacity. Say yes more. Say yes more. Man, there's some power in that yes. All we have to do is say yes to the things. It's amazing. It's like God won't give you awesome, amazing things to do, but until you start saying yes to the kind of the mundane, simple things. I mean, we just read about Saul. Saul said, yeah, Dad, I'll go look for the donkeys. And it was on that donkey trip that God spoke to him and anointed him king of all of Israel. Come on, just say yes. Just say, yeah, it could be something simple. It can be something meaningless, but it can be the exact moment that God is testing your obedience to take you to further places. Say yes. You know, this is a great first step. I love this. Like when you get saved, you give your heart to Jesus. Jesus gives you a simple opportunity. He says, get baptized. Say, I was baptized. It's this symbol. It's like, you know, that's our first yes to the Lord, is to say, Lord, I'm going to do this thing. And we just simply saying yes. And in that yes, we begin to increase our willingness. And in the increase of our willingness, we're increasing our capacity. And then God can begin to use our abilities, gifts, and talents. God can't use your no. I believe that the world is hungry. There's a groaning. The world is groaning in anticipation. Man, I look on social media, on news, on everywhere, and it seems like it's desperation. And friends, I believe that the world is desperate. And there's no greater time on earth than the world to be hungry and in anticipation for something genuine and authentic. I mean, I remember in those days before I found Jesus, and man, I thought Jesus people were crazy. That hasn't really changed. My opinion hasn't changed. But it's evolved. It's kind of changed in perspective. I still think y'all are crazy, but I think you're crazy for the right reasons. Just like I'm crazy about my wife, I'm crazy about Jesus. And I'll do anything for my wife. I'll do anything for Jesus because I believe it's powerful. It's not a club or a social event. And people are hungry for the authentic move of God on the earth today. They're hungry for something meaningful. They want to be part of something bigger. You know, they want to, you look at these movements like Black Lives Matter or LGBTQ+ and all of these things. And really, that's coming from a heart, a yearning within people that God put there to be part of something bigger than themselves. And all at the same time, the church rejects that movement. I believe that we need to start preaching the gospel truth to the world and begin to be authentic in our expression of it. And then watch what God will do. These people want to change the world. I love this in the book of Acts. Man, we had an opportunity with our superintendent earlier this week, and he brought this verse of scripture to light in Acts chapter 17, verse 6. This is talking about the early apostles of Jesus Christ. It says, but when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some brethren to the rulers of the city. They brought these disciples to the rulers of the city, and they said, these who have turned the world upside down have come here too. You see, the people of this world are looking for someone that wants to make a difference in the world that they live in. And as a Christian, as a faithful follower of Jesus, we have the ability to turn the world upside down. People are hungry. The world is hungry. And it's time for the church to increase its capacity. The world is hungry. How many of y'all know what it feels like to be hungry? I mean, after church every Sunday, I'm kind of hungry. And you know, it's interesting how our hunger can change into hanger in just a second. Y'all have heard this term, hangry, right? And it's almost a symptom of what's going on in the world. They are hungry, but because they're not being fed, they begin to be hangry, and they begin to lash out. I mean, I've seen it before. You get me hungry, that's the only time I'm mean to my wife. That's it. She's like, Joe, you need something to eat. Okay, feed me. The world is hungry for the things of God, the things of meaning, the things of purpose. The church is just confusing them with all kind of confusion. I mean, I'm confused. Well, there's one thing I'm not confused about, that Jesus died for me, that Jesus was raised again to new life for me, that on the third day he rose again. He sent his Holy Spirit to come and live and dwell within me. I have the Spirit of the living God living within me, the power of God living in me. The world is hungry. They want to be filled. They're tired of the junk food. They're lashing out because their hunger has turned to hanger. You know, a few years back, I went on this weight loss journey, and I remember I lost about 45 pounds. Man, I was fit as a fiddle. I don't know how fit fiddles really are, but that's about how fit I was. It was awesome. And in that process of trying to lose weight, man, I learned one thing. It's this term called crisis eating. Now, this is not a lesson on food and diet, but how many of you ever heard of this term, crisis eating? Okay, I'm going to teach y'all something today. Crisis eating is basically like you don't have a plan for what you're going to eat that day, so you just get hungry around lunch and say, man, chicken nuggets sound pretty good about now. You see, whenever we begin to crisis eat, when we don't have a plan, a meal plan for that day, you know, then you're just going to be drawn away to every temptation that you see. McDonald's, Wendy's, I'm not saying anything negative about McDonald's or Wendy's, but I'm just saying the shakes are pretty good, especially when you're hangry. And the world, we live in that. If you're trying to lose weight, have a meal plan. You know, go on Sunday and begin to meal prep for the rest of the week. And then whenever you get hungry, you have a little something. You can eat it. It's very good practice. You'll begin to see results in your physical body, and it's going to change your life. It's going to be pretty awesome. Because when we get in these moments where we're hungry and we don't have a plan, you know what happens? We make poor decisions. And we end up with poor health and many other issues. And I believe that the same way that we can meal prep in our physical bodies, we need to learn to meal prep in our spiritual bodies as well. There's so many of us that we just kind of go through life and, man, I'm hungry. And it may not be a physical hunger, it's a spiritual hunger. So we just end up just eating whatever's put in front of us, whether it's Facebook, whether it's Instagram, whether it's the news, whether it's the horoscope, whether it's the gossip chair at the salon, whatever it is, you begin to quickly fall, whether it's tobacco, whether it's alcohol, come on, whether it's sex, whether it's drugs, whatever it is, whatever's put in front of you because you're so hungry for more, you're going to eat it. You become a Christian in crisis because we're not prepared, because we don't have the capacity. We haven't even thought about it. We're just like, I'm going to come to Sunday, check, Monday morning, I'm going to work, and you have no spiritual preparation whatsoever. You have not meal prep for that day. And let me tell you, friends, hunger is going to come because God has put inside your heart this hunger for Him. The world is hungry. The world is hungry. In fact, the devil knows this too, by the way. I mean, the devil knows all of this. He's fully aware of our hungers. He's fully aware of what God put into us, and he tries to battle for that. There's a battle at hand for the hearts of this generation. There's a battle at hand for the hearts of the world, and I'm encouraging you today, church, don't give up on the battle. Come on, we just need to begin to bring something that has value to the table instead of bringing our junk. Or I'm not going to pick on smoke machines or spotlights or LED or any of that stuff. So, but we don't need to bring just the hype and the hip of church, but we need to bring the Holy Ghost and power to the world. And when the world begins to see these things, man, they begin to have that hunger filled within them. There's a battle. It's a battle for the heart. I want to talk a little bit about the heart because we're talking about David. It said he was a man after God's own heart. The heart is important, you know. In fact, the Bible says that we should guard our heart against all else, for out of it flows the issues of life. Why should I be careful of what I allow into my heart? Because out of your heart flows everything of the issues of life. When you let junk in, you're going to get junk out. When you let wickedness in, you're going to let wickedness out. Whenever you begin to look at things you know you're not supposed to look at, listen to things you know you're not supposed to listen to, talk to people you know that ain't blessing you right now, it begins to have a more of an impact on your life than you may realize. Come on, somebody. Guard your heart. Guard your heart. Look at your neighbor and say, guard your heart. How do we guard our heart? This is what the Bible says. that we should hide the word in your heart, that you shall not sin against God. It's this idea of displacement. I put something in and it pushes something else out. When we begin to hide the word of God in our heart, it begins to bring transformational power. When we begin to say, look, I love watching TV. I love sitting on the sofa and splurge watching whatever you call that, television shows, right? I didn't even know that you can do this until recently, but I'll sit there and do it. But then quickly, I realized that, man, I could have spent time studying the word. I could have spent time in worship, in prayer. I could have spent time encouraging the faithful believers of the church instead of just wasting my time by doing things that are pointless. Paul says that we should redeem the time, for the days are wicked. We need to hide the word in our heart that we shall not sin against God. Memorize scripture. These Bible reading plans is just not a great suggestion. Friends, this is a mandate. This is something that God tells us to do. Hide the word in your heart. Because out of the mouth, the heart speaks. I mean, so many times in the church, we see people say stupid stuff. Y'all heard me say stupid stuff before? We say stuff and we're like, man, you need to quit saying that. You need to quit talking like that. You need to quit behaving like that. You need to quit doing all this stuff. We get so focused on the outcome that we lose sight of what's really important, and that's what's going in. One of my favorite worship leaders and pastors, when in his songwriting, he says, we don't try to filter what comes out of our heart. We filter what goes into it, and then what comes out of it will begin to be pure and holy. And we live in this Christian world where we're trying to, brother, you shouldn't say like that. You shouldn't dress like that. You shouldn't talk like that. You shouldn't do this. Forget that. Put the word in there, and all that other stuff's going to go away. I've seen it happen in my own life. I tried to do the religious thing. I tried to get it right. I mean, I tried to quit smoking every day for 5 years consecutively. But until I actually said, Lord, you take it. Done. Why? Because I was trying to filter what was coming out, but I said, Lord, I can't do it. I'm gonna filter what's coming in. I no longer let that stuff into my heart anymore. Amen? Come on, somebody say amen. This is an introductory message about David the king, and I want to talk about David here over these next few weeks, because David, he began this legacy of kings. Like, there was all of his son. I mean, he left a legacy for the world. In fact, David is part of the lineage of Jesus. It says that Jesus is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. It says that he is the son of David. He's of the lineage of David. And the Lord says this of David, as we read earlier in 1 Samuel chapter 13. But now your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself. Man, I can preach a message on that. Come on, how many of you know the Lord is looking for such that worship him in spirit and in truth? The Lord is searching you out. He is looking for those whom he can call his own. And it says that the Lord sought for himself a man after his own heart. You know, Jesus is not looking for people with just more pedigrees and degrees. He is looking for people that are searching after him. Jesus says this, you draw nigh unto me, I draw nigh unto you. All we have to do is begin to take a step. We have to put our own agendas, our own hang-ups to the side and chase after God and watch what God will do. It's really amazing. In Acts 13:22. Just to kind of bring this into a New Testament perspective. And when he had removed Saul, he raised up for them David as king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart who will do all of my will. God is just looking for someone who will say yes to him. God is, he's just looking for someone with a little bit of capacity, someone with a little bit of willingness, with a little bit of ability. God is looking for a man or woman after his own heart. I believe that God is looking, he is seeking right now a church that is after his heart. He is looking for a community that is after his heart. He's looking for a city, for a state that is after his heart. That's all he is asking for, is someone who is after his heart. He's not looking for what the world looks for in leadership. He's not. I mean, you know, the world looks for certain things. I mean, I used to be in the business world, and I would help people with resumes. I know what to put on a resume to get you a job, right? I mean, you need to have a degree. The world, God's not looking for degrees. He loves degrees. I'm not saying that degrees are bad, but you're not. I'm not going to say this, but I'm going to say it. God, what does it say? He doesn't qualify the called. He doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. I didn't want to say that. Probably shouldn't still. But he's not interested in what the world sees in leadership. He's interested in people who are willing to chase after him, who are after his heart. He's not looking for degrees. He's not looking for experience. Man, I would just as soon take somebody who's on fire for Jesus than someone who's been serving him lukewarm for 50 years. I mean, there's so many people in church, they've got like 20 years worth of one-year experience in Christianity. They grew 1 year and then they stayed that way for 20 years. Friends, chase after God. Man, I've been saved for 20 years and my testimony shouldn't just be salvation anymore. That's one of them. But man, God is still working. God is still moving. God is still doing in my life today. He's not interested in experience. He's not interested in talent. I mean, he's given you the gifts, and those gifts are irrevocable. But friends, he don't have to use them. He's more interested in your heart than your abilities. He's not interested in your connections. I know this guy. I know this guy. I got this business owner. I got this guy. Man, all of that stuff is great and fine, but I want you to know, as an agent, an ambassador for the kingdom of heaven, that stuff can turn around really quickly. And you can so fight for a connection that you lose your authenticity to the things of God. It's called being sold out. God's not interested in your connections. He's not interested in who you know, as long as you know him. I mean, Jesus even sells this parable out about a man who gave and who prophesied and who healed the sick. And Jesus said, but I know you not. It's not about the things you do, the talents, the connections, all that stuff, your giftedness. It's about having a heart after his. That's what David had, a heart after his. Man, God can do so much with a heart after his. I can start listing people off, but Mother Teresa, I mean, changed India. She was older at the time. God's not interested in your youth. He's not interested in your age. He's interested in your heart. He's looking for someone who's after his heart, someone who's willing to say yes, someone who has the ability, someone who has some capacity. And in this story, we see that God removed the people's choice and he put in there his choice, right? Because he's looking for someone. What was David's qualification? A man after God's own heart and will do what he wills. That's it. That was David's qualifications. Someone who's after his heart and who says yes to him. So I have just three quick points this morning. What does it mean to be after God's heart? And I believe that it means that we're willing to do the will of God on the earth. We're willing to do what God tells us to do. We're willing. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, I'm willing. Be careful that Jesus said to Peter, he said that the flesh is willing, but the spirit is weak. We need to begin to build up our spirit, man. We need to begin to be ready to do the things of God. Because listen to this, the things that God calls us to do are not convenient. They're not convenient. It's not an act of convenience. It's not like, well, if I have some time today, Lord, I'll go do what you asked me to do. Friends, you need to make that the priority operation of your heart, is to do the will of the Father. I love Dave Ramsey. If you haven't done the Dave Ramsey plan, do it. It's great stuff. But he has this little saying. He's talking about money. You know, he says, don't worry. If you don't have a plan for your money, somebody else will. Come on, I can correlate that to our spiritual walk. Don't worry, if you don't have a plan for your life and faith, don't worry, the devil's got one for you. He will drag you to every place on the earth, chasing after something that don't even exist, when the reality is God just wants your heart right now. He wants you to do his will right now, and doing the will of God is not convenient. David learned to do what was needed. He did what was necessary. We first see David out in the field as a young shepherd boy, protecting the or protecting the flocks of Jesse. Was it convenient? Shepherding is not convenient, but you know, God formulated David's heart in that field. Doing the will of God on earth is not about being popular. In fact, it's going to have the opposite effect. I just want you to know. You see, David, when he's there doing the will of God, he's tending the sheep. He's learning from the Lord. While his brothers were standing before the prophet, David was alone in the field. You know, when Saul was having his exploits and all of this stuff, David was alone in a cave. We realize that doing the will of God is not popular. Doing the will of God is not about doing what's easy. It's not about doing what's easy. Following the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, it's not convenient, it's not popular, and friends, it's not easy. We see David later on. We're going to talk about these in more detail later, but David, he comes to the battlefield on this day, and he sees this giant, tall guy, you know, one of the sons of Anak, a man named Goliath, and he sees that this one man has the entire army of God in fear. And it wasn't It was a seemingly impossible situation. And David says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that dares defy the armies of the living God? How many of you know, I think the hardest thing about what happened in that moment was David actually going to the king and saying, okay, I see the giant, everybody's scared, but send me. Send me. It's not about being easy. Serving the Lord is hard work. It's still better than the alternative. And I believe the world is looking for authentic move. They want to see, I mean, we're all looking for the answer of you know, who is God? Is there a God? At some point in time, you're going to grapple with this idea. And there's that easy yes or no answer. I'm going to just tell you, man, the no answer is never fulfilling. Even those who are atheists, I believe they're just liars in denial. You know, they believe that there's something bigger to this whole thing. And they have a struggle putting their finger on it. But we have to understand that the world is hungry for truth, and we have the answer. We don't have to back down or be afraid of that. It's not easy. Acts 13:23, from this man's seed, this talking about David, according to the promise God raised up for Israel, a Savior, who is Jesus. You see, Jesus didn't take it the easy way either. You see, Jesus was the son of David. He was from the lineage of David. He was from the family of David. Jesus never took the easy way. In Luke 22:42, Jesus actually says this. He says, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Man, as Christians, We don't have the obligation of saying, well, Lord, let me think about that and I'll let you know. Because what we do is not easy. What we're called to do is never easy. Jesus didn't take the easy way either. So how do we be a person who's after the heart of God? We do the will of God on the earth. Number two, we leave a legacy of hope and faith. We be intentional about leaving a legacy. God is a legacy-leaving God. God is one who's concerned about the next generation. David was a man who invested into the lives of those around him. I mean, think about this. David, even when he was out in the wilderness and he was out in exile, the mighty men of valor, they came to David and David invested into them. David invested into Solomon and his sons. David, he established worship in the tabernacle. I can't wait to talk about what David did with worship. What we do in worship is not what David had in mind in worship. Can I just say that? Is that all right? I mean, a while back, I mean, I came to this revelation through a friend of mine, Gabe Allred, that how we worship, even today in our church, is not how we're supposed to be worshiping in our church. I mean, David was a dancer. David was a singer. David was a shouter. David was a kneeler. David was a jumper. David was a shouter. They have this one word called shigianoth. It was like, this means to praise. It just means crazy, erratic praise to God. this is worship. David established them. When you read the book of Psalms, which was written by who mostly? David. There's like 7 or 8 different words for praise that's translated in there. And none of them means, thank you, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. None of them. This is not worship. All of them mean an action. He taught us to worship. David fought for the next generation. You know what I love about David the most? He repented quickly when his sin was revealed because David cared about his future. He cared about the future of those coming after him. I care about this church. I care about this church. I've only been pastoring here for 4 years and I'm only 43 years old. I know I've got some years left, but I'm already thinking about, Lord, how can I set up for the next generation? The next pastor of this church may be in this room. I don't know. The next pastor of this church may not even be born yet. I don't know. But whatever it is, I'm thinking about who is that next person. I want to leave a legacy in my life for my children, for your children, for this church, for this community. It's not just about building buildings and building churches and social clubs and networks, but it's about turning the world upside down with Jesus. I mean, it's powerful. 1 Samuel 16:7 says this, but the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature because I have refused him. This is talking about Saul. He says, for the Lord does not see a man what a man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart, and our heart should be oriented toward the things of God. I know people who do great things with a bad heart. I know people who do great things, but their heart is far from God. Their motivations are self-serving. I mean, even in their giving, they have to publicize it all over the internet and TV. When Jesus said, when you give, give in secret. And the Lord, he will reward you publicly. He said, don't, it's not sin, just those who give and on the street corner, they have their reward and that's it. You know, no crowns in heaven. We can do great things, but we don't have the heart of the Father. God is looking for someone. He's looking for someone today that will chase after the heart of God. God doesn't see the outward appearance. He sees what's the heart. Our very motivations need to come from the heart. In John 14:12, Jesus says this. He says, most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do because I go to my Father. You see, David was less concerned about saying, hey, look what I did, look what I did, look what I did, look what I did. He's saying, look what you can do, look what you can do, look what you can do. Jesus wasn't concerned about saving the world in that moment. Jesus was concerned about preparing a group of people who were going to go and turn the world upside down for him. You see, The whole context of the gospel is that we serve the next generation. We're raising up future leaders. I mean, yeah, the rapture could happen tomorrow, but you know, one of these great theologians and very smart people said, what would you change in your life if you knew that the rapture was going to happen tomorrow? You know what he said? He said, I would go and plant a tree. You know, trees take a long time to grow, but regardless of if the rapture happens tomorrow, next week, next year, in 100 years, in 1,000 years, it shouldn't change what we're going to do today, and that's investing in the lives of those who are coming after us. Jesus, he said, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and on earth. He says, here's the keys to death, hell, and the grave. Take them and go do something with them. Go set some captives free. Friends, we have the keys to death. He gave it to us because one of the aspects of being after God's heart is to think about the next generation, to have a heart of investing into the lives of others. Last point, worship team, you can come on up. And then we're going to have communion here in just a moment. The third aspect is that we have to be after the heart of the Father. I know it's kind of like, well, after God's heart, but we have to be actually after God's heart. You know, David is a unique figure in history, totally unique. I mean, I've read books about Ulysses S. Grant. I've read books about Abraham Lincoln. I've read books about I mean, leaders from throughout history. But we have a unique glimpse at David. He's a unique figure in history because we know about all of his pains, about all of his failures, about all of his triumphs, because we have the Word of God. We have the book of Psalms. We have a glimpse into the heart of David through the Psalms. I mean, it's a unique perspective that we have of David, of what was his heart like? What did he think? And man, you read the Psalms, it gets pretty raw. You know, we think, oh, leaders should never act like that. Well, their actions probably aren't exactly lining up with what's in their heart because, you know, it says in the Bible that man looks on the outside, but God looks at the heart. And I believe that even in the midst of David's screw-ups, that he still had a heart that was after the Father. And the books of Psalms gives us a glimpse into the heart of David. We get to see what David saw that others didn't see. We get to see what God saw in David that we can't see. If we just had the Bible without the Psalms and you read David's life, he would just be another conquering king. We would just read about a man who did pretty good, had some failures, repented, and led an army and handed it over. Not even in that, he didn't even do that great. But because we have the book of Psalms, man, we have a glimpse into the heart of a man who is after God's heart. Jesus said this. David said this. He said this. This is his perspective. He said, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress. The Lord is my rock and my fortress. Everything that I have is His. Everything that I stand upon is Him. He will protect me. He will guide me. He is the strong tower that the righteous can run into. I put my full weight in Jesus." This is David's heart. Man, there's some of us here today that are dealing with some pretty significant issues. I mean, I could be in any room and anywhere in the world and I can say that. It's a true statement. I mean, life is tough. And God's less concerned about how you deal with every single situation than He is with where's your heart in it. I may make a bad decision, but Lord, You are my rock. Mighty fortress is our God. David had this perspective. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd." I mean, this is a beautiful image. The Lord, He leads me. He guides me. He comforts me. He cares for me. He looks after me. He's there for me. He protects me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. This is David. This is the heart of a leader. How do we have a heart oriented to be after God's heart? This is what God is looking for. And it's having an understanding that the Lord is my rock. The Lord is my fortress. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my light and salvation. And no matter the darkness, no matter the difficulties, no matter the troubles, no matter the pain, no matter the suffering, the Lord is my light. You don't know how many times I go through what seems to be an impossible situation. These moments, I'm like, "Lord, I can't even see what is happening. This is impossible." And you know what? It's not like God gives me this, you know, 3-step plan to fix all your problems. I haven't gotten one of those. But He says, "I'm here for you, Joe. I'm here with you, Joe. No matter what you're going through, I'll be here when you get on the other side of it. I'll be here while you're going through it. Matter of fact, I'm here with you right now because God is my light and my salvation." I've been in some dark places. He's guided me. I've made some bad decisions. He's there with me. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. He never abandons us. He never forgets. It says, I mean, even God, He remembers us. He remembered Noah. He is our light. He is our salvation. Lord, change my heart. When David said, "He is my strength. He is my shield." Lord, when I am weak, You are strong. When I don't know what to do, where I don't know where to go, Lord, you are there with me. Lord, change my heart, Lord. Teach my heart to obey you. Let my heart be strengthened in you today, Lord. That David said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. He knew his faults. Well, don't let your faults keep you from fulfilling God's promise in your life. Remember, your boneheadedness does not disqualify God's sovereign authority in your life. It may postpone it, but it doesn't stop it. Well, the Lord is your strength. He is your shield. He will protect you. He will vindicate you. He will be there for you. He will give you a clean heart. He will renew your spirit. He will strengthen you and encourage you and be there. Well, this is the heart of the Father. I mean, sometimes we get so caught up on other stuff. In Luke 2:49, this is when Jesus was like the first lesson that Jesus taught us. 12-year-old Jesus in the temple teaching the scribes and the Pharisees, and his parents come looking for him, and they say, and Jesus said, "Why do you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" You know, my pastor up in Missouri, he has a ministry that sets slaves free from captivity in Pakistan. Slavery is still a thing in Pakistan, and his ministry is to set them free and get them a job and get them some health and get them. And people come to him with all kinds of problems. And I love his response. He's like, "Guys, I'm too busy setting captives free to worry about what you're doing or what you're going through." And sometimes that just needs to be our perspective, is like, man, I'm about the Lord's business. Because typically it's bigger than our circumstances. You know, what God is doing in us is bigger than us. So this morning, I just want to respond in a couple ways. This is what we're going to do. I'm going to have the worship team. They're just going to play a song. And I want you just to look in your heart. I just want you to look within and say, "Lord, am I after your heart today? Or have I been pulled away to other things? Lord, have I become insensitive to your voice because there's other voices that are too loud in my life?" So we're just going to sing. I want us to sing this song. Would you just look into your heart? And just a moment of confession, a moment of giving your heart to Jesus this morning. And then we're going to respond by receiving communion.
Every moment I'm away. every moment I'm away. Have your way in me.
Could you stand with me this morning? Ask our ushers if they would come and give us a hand. I'm going to ask the worship team to continue to sing this. And I want to invite you to sing with us as we partake in communion together. So the ushers will give you some instructions as you come and just receive the elements this morning. Would you just kind of come down each aisle on the sides, and then you can return to your seats either on the outermost part aisle or right in the middle. As you come receive those elements, would you take those back to your seat with you and hold them as we partake together? Amen. Ushers, if you would you begin to serve? Come on, can we just sing this together?
This is my desire.
Oh,
Would you take this wafer in your hand? You know, each year, David, King David, and all of the Israelites would celebrate Passover. And Passover, in a sense, was a celebration in anticipation for what God's going to do through the Messiah, the promised one. But today we have an opportunity to celebrate what God did through his Messiah, the promised one. So as we hold this wafer in our hand, we know that this represents the body of Christ that was broken for us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Can we just repeat this simple sentence? Lord Jesus, thank you for allowing your body to be broken for me. Thank you, Jesus, for healing me and setting me free. In Jesus' name, can we partake together? Would you take the cup? Paul reminds us, in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As we hold this cup, it represents the blood of Jesus that was shed for each and every one of us. This blood of the new covenant. The new covenant simply represents a law that's not written on scrolls, but a law that is written upon our hearts. That it's through the blood of Jesus that a way has been making for us to be a people who are after God's heart. So right now, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your blood that was spilt on Calvary. Lord, I pray that even now, Lord, let it bring healing and redemption, hope and promise to each and every person here. Lord, we thank you for it, and we give you all the glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Well, can we partake together? Amen. This morning, I want to just, in service, was just a moment of prayer, but I'm going to ask the worship team just to continue to play. Can we do that? Lord, I give you my heart this morning. And if you just need prayer this morning, we want to invite you. Maybe you've been distracted. You've been pulled away. You've been broken. You've been hurting. Maybe you just need to say, Lord, I need to give my heart to Jesus. Would you come find one of my friends here at the altar who are wanting to pray for you and bless you and come into agreement with heaven for you? So altar workers, if you'll make your way, and if you need prayer this morning, we want to invite you to come and find someone to pray. If you've made a commitment to follow Jesus as your Lord and Savior and have never been water baptized, you can do that today. Would you just come and meet Pastor Desmond right over here at the cross and let him know you want to be baptized today? And we'll baptize you right here, right now. Come on, somebody. Amen. Amen. Come on, right, everybody, just extend your hands. Lord, we thank you for your grace and mercy. Lord, I thank you that you have given us a way to be a people after your heart. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Come on, can we give Jesus some praise? Amen.